please get a bigger room. So last year we had a room that seated 80, and there was still a line out the door. And we asked for a bigger room, and here we are! So please use the app. People pay attention to the feedback inside it, and it helps improve the conference overall. So, once again, everyone, thank you all for coming. This morning we're going to be kicking off the community DevRoom with our first presentation from Sage Sharp on countering imposter syndrome culture. Sage, thank you very much for coming.
All right, will you raise your hand if you cannot hear me? Or if you can hear me? Okay, cool. So I'm going to talk a little bit about how to counter imposter syndrome culture. Just for a show of hands, how many people don't know what I mean by imposter syndrome? Okay, cool. And for people on the live stream, we'll cover it too. So imposter syndrome is actually, the term was first coined in 1978. It's a bit of a mouthful to break down, but basically it is the internal feeling of feeling like you're fake, like you're an imposter, and feeling like you're not intelligent, you're not creative, you're not competent, even though you have evidence of high achievement, of being doing smart things, of being competent, of being creative. So those two pieces are very important. That you must also, you must feel like you're an imposter, like you're a fake, and also have evidence of that high achievement. So a lot of people in the room, for the people who are watching the live stream, there was not very many people that raised their hand and said they hadn't heard of imposter syndrome before. So if you've heard of imposter syndrome, some of you might be going, oh no, not another imposter syndrome talk, because it's been talked a lot about in tech. However, this talk is about how our technical and free software culture really creates the feeling of imposter syndrome, and what we as technical people, as free software people, can do to change the culture that causes imposter syndrome. So it's a little bit different. One of the things that I want to cover is a bit about why we see especially that marginalized people, that people from groups underrepresented in free software really feel imposter syndrome, they're more likely to feel imposter syndrome. And part of that is based on some of our assumptions. So when people who are privileged to attend a conference, who have the financial means, who can take time off to attend a conference, when they look around, they will see a particular majority. And the people who are from groups underrepresented in tech, they're not going to see themselves reflected in our community, reflected in the speakers, reflected in the people who organize conferences. And so part of imposter syndrome is looking around and going, do I belong here? I don't know. And also the fact that people who are the part of the majority in free software may assume, if they see someone that doesn't look like them, that they aren't a real contributor. And this is actually true if you start to look at things like American tech companies. Because of hiring practices at tech companies, if you are a person of color, you're not as likely to get a job as a developer. You're much more likely to see people of color in a job like a janitor or the cleaning staff or security personnel. And that means that privileged folks, when they see a person walking through their building in a company who is a person of color, they may assume that that person is not a contributor. They're not a free software contributor. They're not a technical contributor. And that actually leads to people, this person went to an awards ceremony and they were a person of color, and a white woman assumed that they were part of the wait staff at this awards ceremony and tried to hand them her napkin. And so if you are a person of color and you constantly receive these signals that say you don't belong here, you're going to feel like you don't belong here. The other thing is that a lot of times, even when we try to get people who are from groups underrepresented in free software into free software, people of privilege, white people, are much more comfortable in them being a junior in a junior role than them being in a senior role. So this is a person that's expressing that when they started to achieve more, when they started to, people started saying, you don't deserve those achievements. You shouldn't talk about those achievements. Why are you bragging? Why are you boasting? And part of imposter syndrome is feeling like all your accomplishments are due to luck. And so if we tell people, especially marginalized people in tech, that they shouldn't brag about their accomplishments, that they shouldn't boast about them, that they don't deserve those, then they start feeling like it's just luck. The other part of imposter syndrome is feeling like you're a failure, like you don't deserve what your accomplishments. There's also a fear of not being seen as smart, and feeling like everyone knows more than you. Sorry, I skipped ahead. Right. So I personally experience imposter syndrome as a gender minority in tech. I have very high standards for myself. But then when someone tries to thank me for what I've done, or talk about my achievements, then I can't internalize their praise. And so that's how I experience imposter syndrome. If you look at someone and you're trying to figure out whether they experience imposter syndrome, often it shows up as them looking like they're humble, or maybe they have low self-esteem, or they're like a real perfectionist. A lot of times, people who have imposter syndrome, because they have very high standards for themselves and they're afraid of being seen as a failure, they will often really polish their work before they submit it. You'll see it has to be perfect before they can contribute it. They may downplay their accomplishments. Like if they're, they may say things like, I'm not a real developer, I'm not a real speaker, even though they do develop code and they do speak. And if you, thank them for their work, oftentimes what you'll see is that they will say, yeah, but, and start to criticize their work. And so you may see them tear down their own work when they're thanked for it. The other thing that you may see is that they may be hesitant to ask questions in public. And part of free software is contributing in public, is asking questions in public. And so, but because they're afraid to be seen as not smart, they're hesitant to ask questions in public. Which brings me to the next point. Why would you be hesitant to ask questions in free software? This is one of the myths that we'll tear down in this talk. And some of it is some of our free software culture telling people, RTFM, go Google it. Well, everyone knows this. Or even, pretending to be surprised when someone says that they don't know about something, feigning surprise. All of these signals tell people, I shouldn't ask that question. I should, hide that I don't know about this. The other thing is that the basis of free software technical writing can also lead to imposter syndrome. So I recently had someone, actually it was back in November, someone submitted a pull request to my repository, which is a Django website. And this wasn't a pull request that I wanted. It wasn't an issue that was open. They just submitted it. And it turned out they were a technical writing student at a university, and they were submitting pull requests to two projects to try to get some experience in doing their technical writing. And their change log for their pull request was very interesting, and I've highlighted specific words that I want you to think about. The words that they're, the stuff that they're trying to remove, are they're trying to remove ambiguity. They're trying to remove language that sounds unsure. They're trying to make it more formal and clear and authoritative. And that's exactly opposite of what we want for people to ask questions. If we are encouraging people to ask questions, but we can't admit to ourselves when we're unsure of how our project works or whether it works correctly, if we can't give up some of that authority to be honest about when something might not work right, then we are perpetuating this myth of everyone is perfect, the software is perfect, and no one should ask questions. Technical language basically turns us all into frauds. We don't admit when our project is hard to use. When's the last time you were reading through documentation and someone said, this might take a while, this part of the UI might be confusing to you, I'm sorry. People don't admit those kind of things. But if you're working with free software and you are running into trouble and the documentation doesn't admit that this might be a troublesome spot in your software, you can internalize that it's your fault that you're stuck. We often, when we submit our contributions, we're trying to get them in, we're trying to make sure that they're right and convince the other person that they're right, but we don't admit, hey, this part of the code I wrote at 1 a.m., like, this might not be correct, but it works for me. We don't admit when our contributions could need a little bit more polish because we want to get them in. There's also a culture around in free software of, you know, trying to keep up with the latest trends, trying to understand the latest technologies. And oftentimes, we don't admit when we're not a subject expert. We will just nod along with someone else that's talking about something that we don't really understand. We don't feel comfortable asking questions. And if we don't feel comfortable asking questions, then we're also perpetuating imposter syndrome in others. Because basically, if we're not honest in our documentation about what works, where we're unsure our code works, we are making people feel like when they're confused, it's their fault. It's a lie that we tell newcomers to open source because we don't want our project to be seen as less than perfect. So the solution is to actually model when you're uncertain. If you're unsure of how to make a technical decision, if both paths are, you know, equally confusing or you know, equally fine either way, model that. Say, I don't know how to do this. This is something, I'm just picking one. If you think that your contribution might be incorrect or that some of the code might be buggy, be honest about that. You know, say, I don't know if this part of the code works. I've tried it. I've written some tests, but I'm still not sure if it's completely correct. If you are writing some documentation for your free software project and there is a part of it that is hard to understand or hard to use, be honest about that. Because when someone finds a problem, runs into a problem, then that documentation may help them. And if you don't understand a technical word or a technical concept, please, like, speak up. You can normalize asking questions. You know, you can do things like in your documentation, trying to make sure that there's a help form for folks to try to get help if they have questions, and really if it's in that troublesome spot, saying, hey, if you need help, ask here. Actually having people to answer questions about your software project is useful, having a welcome committee. And that it's sometimes it's as simple as just changing how you phrase the question. So if you're working with another peer, you're maybe doing a peer review, ask, what questions do you have, rather than, do you have any questions? Because if you ask, do you have any questions, then their instinctual answer is going to be no, because they're afraid to ask questions. But if you ask, what questions do you have that shows you're expecting questions, that you're expecting feedback from folks? The second part of imposter syndrome is that a lot of people who experience imposter syndrome feel the need to not brag about their accomplishments. Sometimes they might feel like they're a failure, and so they're more humble about their accomplishments than others. Oftentimes, when people who experience imposter syndrome are thanked, there's this reflex of, this person thinks that I've, so for example, if someone came out to me and said, afterwards and said, thanks, that was a great talk, you're a great speaker, I would, as a person who has imposter syndrome, think, well, this person thinks I'm awesome, but like if they really knew how I struggled and how this morning I edited my slides and it's still really not clear for English speakers, non-English speakers, and. I can tear down my talk a lot. And part of that is because of how things are worded. And these are hacks that I have learned myself, that I've taught the people around me of how to get around my imposter syndrome, and I'll teach you. So when you're giving praise to someone, instead of just saying thank you, focus on your feelings. Say, I appreciate your talk. I found your talk insightful. I felt really excited about your talk. Because your feelings of excitement, of joy, of inspiration at my talk, I can't argue with those. I can argue you down about how good a talk it is, but if you say you were excited about my talk, I can't argue with your feelings. The other part of imposter syndrome is that for people who experience imposter syndrome, it often seems like everyone else does things effortlessly, that it just shows up, that it's just perfect. And some of that is because of how we praise people's characteristics. So we tend to praise people's static characteristics. We say a person is smart or intelligent. Now, someone doesn't really become unsmart the next day. It's smart is something that's sticky. Smart is something that lasts a long time. And so these are static characteristics. These are characteristics that we tend to think stick with people. People don't say, oh, you're a good developer one day and you're a horrible developer the next day. People don't change their mind about how great a talk is. But these particular static characteristics can actually trigger a flood of doubt in people who have imposter syndrome. And that's because the impact of praising them is if someone completes a task quickly and then you say, oh, you're so smart because you completed the task quickly, the next time the person tries to complete another task and they complete it more slowly, then they'll think, maybe I'm not smart. And that's because you're praising the static characteristic of being smart versus the effort that someone puts into something. And this leads to people hiding when they're struggling. So instead of praising static characteristics like a person is smart, a person is good, a person is great, praise how much effort they put into things. You know, how much time they spent researching things, how much they, you know, read your contribution guidelines and really try to make sure that it was up to those guidelines. The time they spent making good commit messages, documentation, the time they spent trying to reach out to get help and review and feedback. We often pretend that open source and free software contributions are effortless. All we see is a git commit message with the perfect commit and the perfect code. We don't see all of those drafts that went back and forth in the discussion. And so part of what we can do is to actually reference those. If you've got a contribution that has gone through a lot of references, even just adding a link to the discussion of those references, the previous patch sets, that acknowledges that the code didn't land perfect. It went through several iterations of your contribution before it got in. The other things you can do are things like credit the people you learn from. If someone says, hey, you really write good commit messages, and you could say, yeah, I really learned from this other person over here, and maybe you could learn from them too. Acknowledging that the effort of learning, the effort of acquiring a skill takes time. This is the kinds of things that can help people who have imposter syndrome. So to wrap up, just some smaller tips for summarizing this. For my first challenge to you is to think about when you see a random person walking down the street. Do you assume they could be a free software contributor? Assume everyone could be a free software contributor. Don't let your unconscious bias limit you there. Think about it, really try to work on it. The other thing I would challenge you to do is to model when you're uncertain in your technical decisions, in the different contributions you make, and really try to document when your project is hard to use. Leave people those little breadcrumbs that, yes, maybe they won't be the only one that's struggling with this particular topic. And the just simple language changes, like asking what questions do you have versus do you have any questions? And talking about trying to praise the effort that someone puts into contributing and not static characteristics like smart or intelligent. And really acknowledging how long it takes to do a contribution, how much effort you have to put into it. And if you're thanking someone using I appreciate or I feel rather than thank you can help people get over that. So I think I have a little bit of time for questions. How are we doing on time?
About 8 minutes for questions.
Okay, cool. Oh, and I would also like to acknowledge that this talk took, I said 25 hours, but it's really closer to 30, and 5 months of like these ideas noodling around in my head. So I just want to acknowledge the effort that I put into this talk. So. All right, so questions? Yes. Or do we have a mic?
We do, the mic is coming. Okay. Where is the question?
So from your experience, how often do you meet someone with imposter syndrome? Like, if I'm part of an open source project, how often am I to expect, okay, this might be it?
So from my experience is a little different because I help run the Outreachy internship program, and we're all about trying to improve diversity in open source. So I work with a lot of people from groups underrepresented in tech, and I would say at least 80% of those have imposter syndrome. So it really depends. It also depends on like your community makeup. I think that you can really look at some of the signs, the external signs I talked about of like people being perfectionist and also having high achievement, but also like tearing their achievements down and start to look at those and figure out.
Just first of all, I want to say thank you. I appreciated your lecture. I found it quite interesting. I recognized a lot of stuff in myself in it. One of the things I find is when my imposter syndrome strikes and I can't reach that level of perfectionist because sometimes you have to incorporate other people's efforts, that kind of immobilizes me. Have you found any smart hacks for getting around the immobilizing factor that comes with imposter syndrome?
right? So there have been times when I'm like, I can't get something to the point that I really want it to be at. And what I have to do is I have to convince myself, I need others' input to improve. This is a draft, and I just have to keep telling myself this is a draft. I'm going to improve it, and I'm going to get feedback. So, for example, for this talk, I expect I'm probably going to give this talk at another venue, and so I'm like, okay, this is a first draft. I just have to do it. So that was how I don't know if that helps.
I very much enjoyed your talk. I've been thinking about how to kind of introduce new people, and for a long time I've just said, like, do it verbosely, but it occurs to me that that could probably also use some improvement. Like, you know, it's like, it's not enough, like, oh, this is my friend Sally who you know, is working on Media Goblin, like, but I could probably do a little more, and I wonder if you had any thoughts on that.
Yeah, I think I have actually had my imposter syndrome triggered by people like introducing me as like, hey, this is Sage, and they were a great Linux kernel developer and did this thing, and I think that we still want to like acknowledge the work that people do, and talk about that, but I think that there is a way. I'm trying to think if there's a way we can turn that around. You can talk about the number of years that they've contributed to that. You can say they did this great feature. I feel like there are ways we can talk about people's effort, people's work, without adding those static characteristics to it. So that helps. Yeah.
Additional questions, folks?
Ah, very good.
Thank you so much. Creating a thank you culture helps people like that. And do you have any concrete advice to create this kind of praise environment, if I can?
I think there's a couple things. The Recurse Center has some very good social rules. One of the social rules is don't feign surprise. Don't pretend to be surprised when someone doesn't know something. And I think that really created a culture where people could ask questions. Another thing that they did at Recurse Center when I was there was they had daily stand-ups where people just said, hey, this is what I'm working on. And that allowed people to be like, and I'm also stuck on this, right? And so that helped. For the praise part, what I've tried to do is I've tried to praise the people that do the most unenjoyable things. So like when someone submits a bug to my project, I'm like, thank you so much for like finding this bug. I'm so glad that you were able to help me notice this, because this is something I didn't notice, right? And I think that there is also a way to thank someone for their contributions without like talking about the perfectionism of it, but saying like, especially when someone submits a draft, of saying like, I can really, you know, I can tell that you put a lot of effort into like this part. You know, I think that this part could use a little bit more polish, but basically like balancing it out, right?
Okay, we have time for two more questions, so I'm going to start here.
Just want to say this really resonates with myself, and so I'm very, very grateful for such a great subject. So my question kind of follows on the previous, where let's say we have a community of hundreds, thousands. How do we break that down? Because I assume there's lots and lots of imposter syndrome people in that section. How do we break it down to encourage them to take that first step? So for example, would we set up events where this isolated event, the disclaimer would be everyone is welcome, there's no limitations, there's no restrictions on what you can provide. Do you have any suggestions of any other way of trying to isolate and get them more involved?
Right. I think that especially when it comes to events, people who have imposter syndrome are afraid to speak because they feel like they don't, first of all, have the experience to do so, but even if they do,